यमुना तीर वनचारी यमुना तीर वनचारी जयो राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जयो राधा माधव कुंज बिहारी जय श्री श्री राधा माधव की श्रील प्रभुपाद की। आई जस्ट वी हैव अ बुक और ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय Today we are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, The Status Quo, Chapter 24, The Renunciation of Kardam Muni, verse number 34. Asma vipriche adva patim prajanam त्वयावतीर्नर्न उत्ताप्तकाम परिव्रजत पद्वीम आश्रितो अहम् चरिष्ये त्वाम हृदि युञ्जन् विशोख सॉरी We do the next one? Okay, sorry. So reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Chapter 24, The Renunciation of Kardam Muni, verse number 35. Shri Bhagavan Vacha Maya Proktam Hi Lokasya Pramanam Sat सत्यलौकिके अथा जनिमय तुभ्यं यद् अवोचमृतं मुने श्री भगवान उवाच मया प्रोक्तं हि लोकस्य प्रमाणं सत्यलौकिके अथा जनिमया तुभ्यं यद् अवोचमृतं मुने श्री भगवान उवाच मया प्रोक्तं हि लोकस्य प्रमाणं सत्यलौकिके अथा जनिमया तुभ्यं यद् अवोचमृतं मुने प्लीज रिसाइट भगवान उवाच मया प्रोक्तम हि लोकस्य मां सत्यलौकिके जनी मया तुभ्यं यदवोचमृतं मुने श्री भगवान उवाच मया प्रोक्तं हि लोकस्य प्रमाणं सत्यलौकिके अथा जनी मया तुभ्यं यदवोचमृतं मुने श्री भगवान उवाच मया प्रोक्तं हि लोकस्य प्रमाणं सत्यलौकिके अथा जनी मया तुभ्यं यदवोचमृतं मुने माताजी श्री भगवान उवाच मया प्रोक्तं हि लोकस्य प्रमाणं सत्यलौकिके अथा जनी मया तुभ्यं यद् अवोचमृतं मुने श्री भगवान उवाच मया प्रोक्तं हि लोकस्य प्रमाणं सत्यलौकिके अथा जनी मया तुभ्यं यद्वोचमृतं मुने श्री भगवान उवाच द सुप्रीम पर्सनालिटी ऑफ गॉड हेड सेड मया बाय मी प्रोक्तम स्पोकन ही इन फैक्ट लोकस्य फॉर द पीपल प्रमाणम ऑथोरिटी सत्य स्पोकन इन स्क्रिप्चर लौकिके एंड इन ऑर्डिनरी स्पीच अथ देयरफॉर अजनी देयर वॉज बर्थ मया बाय मी तुभ्यम टू यू यत दैट विच अवोचम आई सेड रितम ट्रू मुने ओ सेज ट्रांसलेशन एंड परपोर्ट बाय श्रील प्रभुपाद ट्रांसलेशन द पर्सनैलिटी ऑफ गॉड हेड कपिला सेड वॉट एवर आई स्पीक वेदर डायरेक्टली और इन द स्क्रिप्चर्स इज ऑथोरिटेटिव इन ऑल रिस्पेक्ट्स फॉर द पीपल ऑफ द वर्ल्ड ओ मुनि बिकॉज आई टोल्ड यू बिफोर दैट आई वुड बिकम योर सन आई हैव डिसेंडेड टू फुलफिल दिस ट्रूथ Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Kardam Muni was to leave his family life to completely engage in the service of the Lord. But since he knew that the Lord himself as Kapila had taken birth in his home as his own son, why was he preparing to leave home to search out self-realization or God realization? God himself was present in his home. Why should he leave home? Such a question may certainly arise. But here it is said that whatever is spoken in the Vedas and whatever is practiced in accordance with the injunctions of the Vedas is to be accepted as authoritative in society. Vedic authority says that a householder must leave home after his 50th year. Panchashodham vanam vrajet. One must leave his family life and enter the forest after the age of 50. This is an authoritative statement of the Vedas based on the division of social life into four departments of activity: Brahmacharya, Grihastha, Vanaprastha and Sannyas. Kardamuni practiced yoga very rigidly as a Brahmachari before his marriage, and he became so powerful and attained so much mystic power that his father Brahma ordered him to marry and beget children as a householder. Kardamuni did that also. He begot 9 good daughters and 1 son, Kapila Muni. And thus his householder duty was also performed nicely. And now his duty was to leave. Even though he had the Supreme Personality of Godhead as his son, he had to respect the authority of the Vedas. This is a very important lesson. Even if one has God in his home as his son, one should still follow the Vedic injunctions. It is stated, Mahajano yena gata sapantha. One should traverse the path which is followed by great personalities. Kardam Muni's example is very instructive. For in spite of having the Supreme Personality of Godhead as his son, he left home just to obey the authority of the Vedic injunction. Kardamuni states here the main purpose of his leaving home. While traveling all over the world as a mendicant, he would always remember the Supreme Personality of Godhead within his heart and thereby be freed from all the anxieties of material existence. In this age of Kali Yuga, sannyas is prohibited, because persons in this age are all Shudras and cannot follow the rules and regulations of sannyas life. It is very commonly found that so-called sannyasis are addicted to nonsense, even to having private relationships with women. This is the abominable situation in this age. Although they dress themselves as sannyasis, they still cannot free themselves from the four principles of sinful life, namely illicit sex life, meat eating, intoxication and gambling. Since they are not freed from these four principles, they are cheating the public by posing as swamis. In Kali Yuga, the injunction is that no one should accept sannyas. Of course, those who actually follow the rules and regulations must take sannyas. Generally, however, people are unable to accept sannyas life. And therefore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stressed, Kalau nasti eva, nasti eva, nasti eva gatir anyatha. In this age, there is no other alternative, no other alternative, no other alternative than to chant the holy name of the Lord, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare. The main, Ram, 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 Hare Hare. The main purpose of sannyas life is to be in constant companionship with the Supreme Lord, either by thinking of Him within the heart or hearing of Him through oral reception. In this age, hearing is more important than thinking, because one's thinking may be disturbed by mental agitation. But if one concentrates on hearing, he'll be forced to associate with the sound vibration of Krishna. Krishna and the sound vibration Krishna are non-different. So if one loudly vibrates Hare Krishna, he'll be able to think of Krishna immediately. This process of chanting is the best process of self-realization in this age. Therefore, Lord Chaitanya preached it so nicely for the benefit of all humanity.
ॐ अज्ञान तिमिरंधस्य ज्ञानांजन शलाकय चक्षु उन्मिलितं येन तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः नमः ॐ विष्णुपदाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामी इति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेषा शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्णा चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम हरे राम। हरे कृष्णा। सो इट्स माय ग्रेट ऑनर टू बी हियर अमंग ऑल द ग्रेट डिवोटीज। आई सीक ब्लेसिंग्स फ्रॉम ऑल ऑफ यू to be able to render this service of speaking Srimad Bhagavatam. We are reading the section of Srimad Bhagavatam where Kardam Muni, who is a perfect brahmachari and he has got accomplished in the practice of yoga, and seeing him so highly elevated, Lord Brahma requested him to generate population. In the beginning of creation, it is a requirement that the souls get suitable bodies, so that when they get human body, is that okay? Thank you. When they get human body, they can practice devotional service and quit this creation. And if the population is sattvic and nice, then the society is peaceful. Everybody can coexist. And a good population comes from good parents. So when Lord Brahma saw that Kardamuni is a very nice, accomplished, spiritually elevated yogi, he requested him to generate population so that his progeny would be very good. So Kardam Muni didn't immediately went on a matrimonial website to search a candidate. He went in tapasya and austerities, and he became very skinny. In pure bhakti, meditating and remembering the Supreme Personality of Godhead, so that he gets a suitable wife, a wife of similar disposition. If husband and wife have similar disposition, then it's peaceful. Otherwise, it is in pieces. The situation is not so good. So Lord Vishnu appeared to him, and he offered prayers and obeisances and requested the Lord to fulfill his wish of having a suitable girl to marry. And Lord Vishnu said, I already know your desire, and in 2 days Manu Maharaj will come on a golden throne, golden chariot, and gift his daughter Devahuti, who is a beautiful princess. You marry her and she will be suitable wife, and by my blessings you will have 9 daughters, and I myself will become your son. So Kardam Muni and Devahuti Mata are so elevated that Krishna wants to become their son. Krishna, as Kapila Muni, he will not choose any random couple to be his parents. When he is taking an incarnation, they have to be elevated, suitable for that purpose. So Kardam Muni and Devahuti are very great. They marry and eventually they have 9 daughters and 1 son, Kapil Muni. So when the 9 daughters are married away and Kapil Muni is grown up, Kardam Muni approaches Kapil Muni one day, and there is a conversation which we just read in last few verses. In this conversation, Kardam Muni is offering prayers to his own son, because he knows that my son is Supreme Personality of Godhead, Bhagwan, avatar of Krishna. एंड एट द एंड ऑफ हिज प्रेयर्स ही सीक्स परमिशन फ्रॉम कपिल मुनि दैट माई डियर लॉर्ड आई वॉन्ट टू लीव द गृहस्थ आश्रम एंड बिकम अ मेंडिकेंट बिकम अ सन्यासी सो प्लीज गिव मी परमिशन. So then Kapil Muni responds, and this is the first shloka which we read today, in which Kapila Muni is responding. So to begin with, Kapila Muni says that when you approached me for a wife, at that time I was pleased with you, and I appeared to you giving you darshan, and also mentioned to you that I will become your son. And now I have become your son. So whatever I speak is truth. Whatever I speak is factual. Whatever I speak happens. There is difference between our speech and reality. I may speak a statement, it may or may not be real. Or it may or may not manifest reality. But when Krishna speaks, what he speaks is reality. It manifests reality. So Krishna said, whatever I speak, whether through scriptures or through ordinary conversation, both is similar authoritative for the masses, for the public. For example, Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is a conversation between two friends, Krishna and Arjun, on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, when the war is about to begin. And that became scripture. Scripture is a very high book, Shastra, which is going to guide the society for millions of years. It has to be perfect. It has to be applicable to all times, places and circumstances. So before giving an important scripture to the world, did Krishna made preparation, a rough draft, or a PowerPoint presentation, or had an editorial team? He just had a conversation on the battlefield and it became scripture. For us to speak on one shloka, we have to prepare that I should not make a mistake. I should not speak something which is offending or which is deviation. For Krishna is a Purushaya, he doesn't have to prepare. He doesn't have to work hard. He doesn't has to. Whatever he speaks is perfect. He is perfect. And when we follow a perfect person, we become perfect. If we follow ourselves or our mind, which is imperfect, we remain imperfect. There was once a very intelligent man. He was going from one village to another village to meet his friend. Walking 2-3 hours, he came in the forest and he was very tired, and he saw a water body, a lake. Immediately he jumped in the lake, he swam, he drank water, he felt very refreshed. He said, wow, Krishna is so intelligent, he made a lake in the forest and he arranged rain to fill it and he created water. Water is so refreshing. Very good. He continued walking for 2-3 hours more. It was heavy sun. He was perspiring and it was very hot. And on the street he came under a very huge tree. And it was very cool below the tree, shade. He stopped. He said, wow, Krishna is so intelligent. Right on the street he gave a tree. Above the tree there is sun which is so hot, below the tree is so cool. Very good. And he sat down. It was cool breeze, so he felt sleepy. He lied down. As he was lying down, he saw such a huge tree, so many branches and so many leaves and so many small fruits. And he is a very genius man. As he was observing, he thought, oh, Krishna did one mistake. What mistake he did? Such a huge tree, he put small fruits. And such a small creepers, he put big watermelons. He didn't balance the load. That's not good. Next time what should he do? He should put big watermelons in a huge tree and small fruits in small creepers. The load is balanced. This is not good. One mistake he did. But it's okay, 99 marks out of 100, still okay. And he slept. After 2 hours he woke up. How he woke up? One fruit fell on his head. And he got startled. He woke up, he saw up. He said, thank you Krishna, you didn't put a watermelon here. If there was a watermelon here, I would have died. Krishna is perfect, 100 marks. I am imperfect, Krishna is perfect. So some things we may not understand what is happening around us with our life. But we should know Krishna is perfect. Sometimes there may be loss. Our health may get lost, our wealth may get lost, our job may get lost, our position may get lost, our near and dear one we may lose, our reputation, name, fame we may lose. We should not think something injustice happening with me. We should understand Krishna is perfect. He is taking care of me. Just like a child playing with a toy, after 2 hours of joyful playing, one person comes and takes away the toy and the child cries. Is that a pleasant situation? Generally, no. Mother does that every day. Every day mother gives a toy, after 2 hours take away the toy. And the child cries. But is mother doing wrong? No. When mother takes away the toy, now there is a change of activity. Playtime is over. It is meal time or bedtime or homework time or something else. So mother gives toy, mother takes away toy. All good. In the same way, Krishna gives health, he takes away health. He gives wealth, he takes away wealth. He gives job, he gives a near and dear one. He gives name and fame, he gives reputation, he gives respect. Then he takes away also. And we should not be sad. We should be happy that Krishna is taking care of me. Now this is what, there is a change of activity in my life. If the child is attached to the toy and mother takes away the toy, the child will cry. If the child is attached to mother and the mother takes away toy, child will be happy that now mother will give some other item or mother will give her association and attention. So in the same way, if you are attached to the giver, Krishna, if we lose something, we'll be okay. But if you are attached to what we have received, and when they go away, we will be unhappy. And whatever we have today, which we call my, all are temporary. They one day are going to go away. The soul is permanent, eternal, and the objects are temporary. So one day they are going to go away, so we should not be attached to those. Krishna takes away, that's fine. There is some pain, that is fine. Like a doctor, when we go to a doctor, he puts a needle in the body. It is painful and we say thank you very much. Because we know he is our well-wisher. So some cure in life may come through that way. So whatever Krishna does is perfect. Whatever he speaks is perfect. In the war of Mahabharata, he told Yudhishthira Maharaj to speak lies. Speak lies that Ashwatthama is dead. the son of Dronacharya. And actually Ashwatthama was not dead. But that was the only way to make Dronacharya give up his weapons and get killed. And Yudhishthira Maharaj hesitated to speak lies. And you must have heard Yudhishthira Maharaj had to visit hell for a few moments. Why did Yudhishthira Maharaj visit hell? Some people say because he cooperated with Krishna and spoke lies. No, he visited hell because he hesitated to obey Krishna's order. Dharma is to speak lies, speak truth. But when Krishna says to speak lies, that becomes dharma. Because what Krishna says is dharma at a particular situation. So there was nothing wrong if Yudhishthira Maharaj speaks lies when Krishna says. Vasudev, at dead night, he came out of the prison of Kans. He escaped the prison that is unlawful. Then he traveled to Vrindavan, crossing the river Yamuna. And at night, 12 o'clock, he entered the room of his friend's wife, Nanda Baba's wife, Yashoda Maiya, and kept his boy child and took the girl child to be killed by Kamsa and came back to the prison. Is it dharma to escape the prison? Is it dharma to go to your friend's wife at night 12 o'clock in her room? That too, not from the main door, but from a hiding path? Is it dharma to protect your boy child, take and replace it with a girl child and allow the girl child of your friend to be killed? And Vasudev is a very dharmic person, very moral person. But whatever he did is dharma because Krishna told him to do. So Krishna consciousness is more than ordinary morality, is beyond ordinary morality, transcendental. At the same time, we should not use these examples as a license for not following the law of the gland or not being moral, saying that I can also speak lies as Yudhishthira Maharaj did. No, that is special context authorized by Krishna. We as sadhakas, we should follow the rules of morality, the rules of the land, the country we stay, favorably, and the scriptures. In fact, devotee should follow so nicely that nobody has an opportunity to point a finger at us. If tomorrow we don't follow the laws of the land, they will not say, so and so person did this. They will say ISKCON devotee did this, Prabhupada devotee did this, and we will spoil the name of Prabhupada, we will spoil the name of ISKCON, we will spoil the name of the society and other devotees and Guru Maharaj. So in fact, we should be very, very careful. Many years before, in Juhu, Mumbai, we had a very big every year we have very big Rath Yatra. And the newspaper covered it. And Rath Yatra means so many photos are taken. Which photo newspaper published in the newspaper? Not of Jagannath, not of the cart, not of the devotees dancing, not of some sannyasi, not of some VIP visitors. They published a brahmachari's photo wearing saffron cloth and drinking Coca-Cola. So he must, on the road, somebody offered him, and out of thirst he must have drank. The newspapers clicked that photo and that they publish in the newspaper. Why? Because they want to show something like that, breaking news. They could have shown Jagannath, they could have shown cart. So we should be very careful not to break principles, not to create doubt in somebody's heart about ISKCON, about devotees, about Srila Prabhupada, about our practice. So Kapil Muni told, whatever I speak is perfect and authorized. That's why I am appearing to you. Now a God is sitting in your home as your son and you are taking sannyas. Kardamuni wants to take sannyas. Why there is sannyas? The concept of sannyas. To leave family attachments, to leave earning life, to leave social life and go and search for absolute truth. Absolute truth is sitting in your house. Still Kardamuni wants to take sannyas to give us an example. I, Kardamuni, my son is God, still I am taking sannyas. Who are you not taking sannyas? Which means, in Varnashram, when somebody is a brahmachari and grihastha, he should not continue as grihastha but retire. Varnapras, and then renounce sannyas. Of course, in ISKCON, a grihastha is equal to a sannyasi because he keeps Krishna in the center and serves the temple and the deities in the house. So that is fine. The lifestyle should be like that, not attached to fruitive activities or sense gratification or opulence, but renouncing all the results of our activities and just serving Krishna. So Kardamuni is taking sannyas to follow Vedic literature. Vedic literatures are instructing all humans, civilized humans, that at one point of time, one should give up the householder life, active earning life, sense gratification life, social life, and leave the responsibility to the elder son and purify himself and renounce and preach. And consider whole world as his children and whole world as his house. Be broad-minded, brahmana. So Kardamuni is teaching us as by an example. At the same time, we should understand in Kali Yuga, sannyas is not encouraged. Because sannyas ashram has lots of rules and regulations. And in Kali Yuga, many people cannot follow those rules and regulations. Especially sannyas ashram or even brahmachari ashram should refrain from any intimate association with opposite gender and refrain from any business or having a bank account and amassing lots of wealth or trying to act to earn some profit. That is not renounced ashram. That is not brahmachari or sannyas ashram. Renounced ashram is only for serving Guru and Krishna, no other activity. With complete conviction in the heart that if I serve Krishna, I don't have to do anything else in my life. All perfection will be achieved, all success will be achieved, all requirements will be fulfilled if I serve Krishna. So we should be 24 hours engaged in Krishna service, not engaged in material karma to earn some profit or to come in contact with a woman, opposite gender, or to work towards getting some post and position or opulence and facilities or material respects or followers and disciples or name and fame, or some likes on my channel. We should not be working hard to get something. Love means give. When we give to Krishna, that's love. But if I want something, especially I want something in the name of performing devotional service, then it's not bhakti, it's karma. Or it is karma mishra bhakti, not pure bhakti. That I am serving Krishna and in return I want something. It is not highest. Srila Prabhupada started this ISKCON society to give us the highest process and an opportunity to come on the highest spiritual standard and highest spiritual progress to love Krishna 100%. ISKCON is not just another temple, a Hindu temple to come break some coconut and pray something and go away. ISKCON is so that we practice pure devotional service in association of devotees. So Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Sarva Dharman Parityajya, Mam Ekam Sharanam Braja. Mam means me, Ekam means only me. Krishna says, only me, come to me only, nobody else. So that's why Prabhupada started ISKCON, to develop this surrender, 100% surrender to Krishna, pure devotional service. Of course, the day one we come, we don't become pure devotees. There's a gradual transformation. But we should follow the process to love Krishna 100%. Krishna is not interested in our 90% love. Krishna is not interested in our 99% love. Krishna is not interested in our 99.99% love. He wants 100%. His standard is high. Just like somebody offers us a glass of water, says, Prabhu, have water, 99% pure. Will we accept it? 99% pure water? 1% dirt? No, I want 100% pure water, 100% pure juice. I don't want 99% pure. Our standard is so high. What about Krishna's standard? If a husband tells the wife, I love you 99%. 1% I love somebody else. Will the wife be accepting it? No, she wants 100%. Husband wants 100%. So what, Krishna wants 99%? Krishna also wants 100%. That's why Prabhupada started ISKCON society, to develop 100% love for Krishna. So in the stage of sadhana, I may not be 100%. He reciprocates. My chanting, my hearing, my dancing, my cooking, he reciprocates. But gradually we should come to 100%. How do we come to 100%? By very nice, pure morning program. By chanting every day, attending Mangala Aarti, and Narasingha Aarti, and Tulsi Aarti, and chanting minimum 16 rounds of Hare Krishna Mahamantra on Japa beads, and Shingara Aarti, and Guru Puja, and Bhagavatam class, and four regulative principles, honoring only prasadam. Every day I do that, gradually I become pure. This is the most important part of our bhakti Srila Prabhupada has given us. Purity is the force, and that purity comes by morning sadhana. And we are so fortunate to be part of this wonderful community where there's such a vibrant, strong morning program. So many devotees chanting and dancing early morning. And within morning, four or five hours, we do a very strong morning program that helps us to remain pure and grow in Krishna consciousness. So this is very important, to develop 100% love for Krishna, to purify our heart. So in Kali Yuga, there are people who dress as a sannyasi, but they don't follow the principles of sannyas. They may be in saffron dress, but they may be in private, coming in contact with sense objects, including opposite gender, or amassing wealth. That is pretender, duplicate person. Krishna doesn't, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is famous as Patit Pavan. He is not famous as Kapat Pavan. Kapat means pretender. Junior Haridas example we have, who was a sannyasi who came in contact with Mataji, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu rejected him, did not want to see his face and give association. So sannyasi is not just dress, it is a purity of the heart. Don't judge by dress and by address. Somebody's dress might be saffron, somebody's address might be Vrindavan or some spiritual organization, but that is not sufficient. There has to be heart of a sadhu. There should be good qualities. That is very essential. So in Kali Yuga, the most important dharma is to practice chanting of Hare Krishna Mahamantra. The holy name of Krishna is non-different from Krishna. So when I chant Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे, आई इमीडिएटली कम इन कॉन्टैक्ट विद कृष्णा बिकॉज कृष्णाज नेम इज इक्वल टू कृष्णा. सी इफ आई वॉन्ट वाटर एंड आई से वाटर वाटर वाटर, माई थर्स्ट विल नॉट गो अवे बिकॉज वाटर ऑब्जेक्ट एंड वाटर नेम आर डिफरेंट. इफ आई से मैंगो मैंगो मैंगो, आई नॉट फील समथिंग स्वीट बिकॉज मैंगो फ्रूट एंड मैंगो नेम आर डिफरेंट. बट वेन आई से कृष्ण राम, आई डायरेक्टली कम इन कॉन्टैक्ट विथ कृष्णा बिकॉज कृष्णाज नेम एंड कृष्णा भगवान पर्सन दिस टू आर वन. लेफ्ट हैंड साइड इज इक्वल टू राइट हैंड साइड. सो वेरी ईजिली आई कैन कम इन कॉन्टैक्ट विथ कृष्णा इन कलयुगा बाई चैंटिंग हरे कृष्ण महामंत्र एंड द होली नेम गोज फ्रॉम माई लिप्स टू माई ईयर्स एंड फ्रॉम ईयर्स टू द हार्ट एंड द सोल इज इन द हार्ट एंड सोल गेट्स awakened by contact with the holy name and that awakening process is coming to the conclusion that yes, I am servant of Krishna. That is self-realization and a devotee continues to serve Krishna and gradually becomes pure and at the end of life by Krishna's mercy we can go back to Krishna. No more coming back to Los Angeles or any other part of this world. Go back to Krishna. Krishna is waiting for us. Since how many years Krishna is waiting for us? How many? Time immemorial, eternal, million, trillions of years. Krishna is waiting for us. Now one question I have. How many more long time you want Krishna to wait for you? Why should we make him wait more? So this life, we should be determined to go back to Krishna. And that's possible by following Prabhupada's instructions as it is. Prabhupada said, just follow minimum 16 rounds Hare Krishna Maha Mantra, four regulative principles. I guarantee you. So we don't have to add anything and we should not subtract anything. We just follow as it is what Prabhupada has given. And we can go back to Krishna. So in Kalyuga, that's the most important process. Hare Naam, Hare Naam, Hare Naamaiva Kevalam, Kalo Nasteva, Nasteva, Nasteva Gatir Anyatha. Thank you very much. We will end here. Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai, Hare Krishna. If there are any comments, you want to add anything? Yes, Prabhu, or any questions?
Hare Krishna Prabhu, thank you for a very nice discourse full of practical points. So there's one practical point I want to touch on. Sometimes devotees wonder why I stress so much about the proper Sanskrit pronunciation. So the first line of today's verse is very indicative. Maya, he says, Maya, which means by me, Proktam Ilokasya. So if you pronounce it as Maya, it's completely different. Maya is illusion, not this. It's not Maya, it's Maya. Just the opposite, spoken by me. So many examples are there. So it's very important, and Prabhupada several times interrupted class to get the devotees to pronounce words properly. So today's verse is a very, very good indication of why. Because if you pronounce Maya as Maya, it's completely different meaning, completely different
right,
meaning.
Right.
So one point to you that was brought up, and that you brought up also, about ISKCON's position and how we have to be careful in how we interact with the society. So there's been discussion lately about collections, money. And Prabhupada's class on Sunday brilliantly dealt with that point. He said that we must take money from them, because if we don't take money from them, they will simply spoil it. They will leave it for the dog. They will use it for sinful activities. So we should be very clear on that. It's not that, yes, we have to be careful not to collect money and misuse it. But as a spiritual society, coming in Lord Chaitanya's line, we must take Lakshmi from those who have it and use it in Krishna's service. There should be no confusion about that.
Right. Thank you, Prabhu. Yes, Prabhu.
Thank you, Prabhu. We know that by Krishna's mercy we get Guru, and by Guru we get Krishna. So in this 100% you know, that we have to give to Krishna. No 90, no 99. One time, we heard many times that devotees give the example that Prabhupada was giving a lecture or class, and he says, 100% pure you have to be. And then the devotees were, you know, like kind of nobody enthused. Prabhupada said 90%. And still, you know, the devotees were not that enthusiasm. Okay, 70%, no more, no less than that. So my question to you is, will be that it appears that you still have to be 100% in one sense to the guru to please him, to actually give you that concession. Can you say something?
Right. There are two things I can add to that. One is, when Prabhupada is sharing that at least 70% you do, so your 100% should be for that 70%. You getting me? My effort to reach that 70% should be 100%. And second thing is, Prabhupada is very merciful, so he is saying, you do 70%, 30% I will add from my side, Krishna will get 100%.
Yeah.
So it's a combination.
Yeah.
Right? So we take one step, Krishna takes 1,000 steps. Prabhupada is helping us in that step. So our 100% should be there. So it's not that I have to do 70% chanting, 70% Mangalarti of the month. No, prasad we take 100%, so bhakti also we should do 100%. Right? Is that okay?
Very good. Thank you.
I guess. Yes.
Hare Krishna. How we can understand this point, and you know, sannyas ashram is forbidden in Kali Yuga, and at the same time Bhaktisiddhanta Maharaj, he introduced sannyas and Prabhupada also. So how to put the, okay, for preaching reason, but still is against what is written in a scripture.
Both the things are written. Maybe I will read that Prabhupada's two statements. There are two statements Prabhupada has written. Where is that? In Kali Yuga, the injunction is that no one should accept sannyas. Of course, those who actually follow the rules and regulations must take sannyas. So, earlier it was an automatic routine that after marriage I take sannyas. But in Kali Yuga, nobody is qualified to go through that automatic routine. So one who is very nicely following the rules and regulations, only they should take sannyas, and that too for the purpose of preaching. Right? So in ISKCON also, Srila Prabhupada awarded sannyas to candidates for the purpose of preaching. And ISKCON also has history where some couldn't follow the vows in spite of so much of sadhana and preaching, because Maya is very powerful. So even today ISKCON awards sannyas, but there is a filtering process so that we have less accidents. So it is not for general mass, it is for those who very nicely follow the rules and regulations. Otherwise it will become a laughing stock. Is that okay? You want to pass the mic back, Prabhu? Yeah, thank you.
Thank you for a very wonderful class.
Hare Krishna.
So my question is this, sometime towards the end of Prabhupada's stay here with us, he decided he wanted a Vedic planetarium. He wanted to have in Mayapur, you know, as a central feature of a temple, you know, showing how the universe was according to the fifth canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam. And he asked his devotees, like the Bhaktivedanta Institute, you know, devotees with a science background, to make a working model of that. And they came back to Prabhupada and they said, Prabhupada, we can't do it. They, you know, and Prabhupada, he didn't get discouraged. He proceeded on his own. He read an article by some South Indian pandit about Vedic cosmology, and he had either Hari Sari or Tamal Krishnamurti buy him a ticket and flew him up, and he met with him, and he said, you know, I read your article, and we'd like you to, we have this plan to make a temple, and you know, according to the fifth canto, we want to show the cosmology according to the fifth canto of the Bhagavatam. can you give us a diagram, you know, like a blueprint? And the man said, no, I can't do that. So they get rid of him. So then Prabhupada proceeded with Tamal Krishna Maharaj and Yasodhananda Maharaj. And they were trying to work it out, you know, reading the fifth canto, those chapters that describe how the universe is set up, and particularly Bhumandala. And they came to Prabhupada and they said, Prabhupada, this one point here, we're stumped on this one point, because according to the Bhagavatam, the earth is Bhumandala, or, you know, the earth is flat. And they were referring to, and they kept saying, you know, and they gave the example, you know, if we start in Los Angeles and we fly west, first we come to Japan, then we come to India, and if we keep flying, we'll go right around and we come back to Los Angeles again eventually. So he says, but according to the description of the Bhagavatam, that's not what happens, because it's, you know, it's flat. It's describing something flat. So I read all the conversations recently between, it was 1977 in Mayapur, between Prabhupada and Tamal Krishna Maharaj and Yasodhananda, and they kept bringing up the point, and Prabhupada didn't really resolve the issue. He insisted that it was correct, whatever was in the Bhagavatam was correct, and that they were prejudiced, but he didn't actually explain how to resolve, you know, to their intellectually satisfy them, how they could lay it out. So that's there. Then some years later, Sariputta came along and he presented this idea that there's a sense in which the earth is flat, Bhumandala is flat, but there's a sense in also which it's a globe, and that's recognized in the astronomical Siddhantas. You know, there's different Vedic literatures that also present the earth as being a globe, and he seemed to resolve the issue. He seemed to be able to explain it in that book, Vedic Cosmography and Astronomy, which, according to Judah Karma, who I was speaking with the other day, that's what they're using as the basis for, you know, setting up the Vedic planetarium. So here's my question: how is it that the disciple of Prabhupada was able to resolve the conflict, you know, explain it in such a way that everybody could go, oh yeah, that makes sense, and we'll go with that? And Prabhupada didn't seem to, I won't say couldn't do it, but he didn't at that time. Back in 1970, when he was with Tamal Krishna Maharaj and Yasodhananda, it kind of ended just, they were kind of, okay, Prabhupada, sure, if you say it's correct, we accept it's correct, but they couldn't figure out how to, you know, demonstrate it. Whereas Sariputta gave an explanation in that book, Vedic Cosmography and Astronomy, which now is accepted, and that's going to be the basis. I mean, the best thing I could come up with is once up here in this room here, Prabhupada, back in the early 70s, he was speaking, and Vishnu John Swami asked a question. He said, Prabhupada, Bhaktivinoda Thakur said, I'm leaving, my work is not finished. And Vishnu John asked Prabhupada, what does that mean? And Prabhupada said, well, he's Vaishnav, he could deliver the entire universe, but he's leaving some service for us. So let us complete the work of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. That's the best I can come up. Is that, what do you, I hope the question is understandable.
Or? Right. You mentioned a question, you gave an answer also, completely acceptable.
You gave the answer.
Is that the way to understand it?
Yes. Understand? Very nice. Thank you. Okay, we end here. Thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Hare Krishna. Sorry for the inconvenience. I have back pain, so I am using this chair. Hare Krishna.